Assalamu alaikum dear students, hope you all doing well. In today's lecture we will discuss about phylum Chordata, which is the lost phylum and the most advanced phylum of kingdom Animalia. We are already done with the rest of the phyla, from phylum Porifera up to phylum Protochordata. So we are left with only one phylum, that's phylum Chordata, and in this lecture we will discuss about this phylum in detail. First of all, let's start with the general characteristics of this phylum Chordata or phylum Vertebrata. In the last lecture I told you that when we talk about kingdom Animalia, it's broadly divided into two groups. One is invertebrates and another is vertebrates. When we talk about vertebrates, vertebrates have a notochord, they have dorsal nerve cord, and they have paired gill pouch. When we talk about invertebrates, they lack these very particular structural or functional features. That means they do not have a notochord, they do not have a nerve cord, and they do not have gill pouch. Now let's talk about phylum Vertebrata in detail. We are already done with invertebrates, which includes all the other phyla of kingdom Animalia, which we already studied in our previous lecture. So let's start with the general characteristics of phylum Chordata or phylum Vertebrata. These organisms are bilaterally symmetrical. You know what does that mean? Triploblastic, coelomic organisms. When we talk about this phylum Vertebrata, these are actually the most advanced. That means these are the most complex organisms. They are fully developed, most developed organisms of kingdom Animalia. As compared to the circulatory system of the most of the invertebrates, their circulatory system is closed circulatory system. That means the blood flows in well-defined vessels. That's what we mean by closed circulatory system. The most important features of this very particular phylum is, which distinguishes this phylum from all other phyla of kingdom Animalia, are these three characteristic features. One is presence of a notochord. Another is presence of a dorsal nerve cord. And another is paired gill pouch. First of all, let's talk about notochord. When we talk about notochord, all the organisms which come under this very particular phylum, they have this notochord present at any stage of their life. That means either in their embryonic stage or maybe in the adult stage as well. When we talk about notochord, what notochord actually is, it's a rod-like structure mostly made up of cartilage, and it actually it provides a place for the muscle attachment. It provides support and gives structure to these organisms, to these vertebrates. Another feature of phylum Vertebrata is they have a dorsal nerve cord. Dorsal means, we can say dorsal is backside as compared to ventral, which means front side or the belly side. So dorsal is backside. When we talk about their dorsal side, they have a dorsal nerve cord. Nerve cord means a bunch of nerves which help in the nervous system control and coordination of these organisms. After that, they have paired gill pouch at some stage of their lives. We are going to discuss about this phylum Vertebrata in detail. So this phylum Vertebrata is further divided into five classes. So let's start with the first one, that's class Pisces. This class Pisces includes fishes. It includes all the fishes, and these are exclusively aquatic. Exclusively means all the organisms which come under this group, under this class, are aquatic. That means they live in water, either in freshwater or marine. After that, their skin is covered with scales, as you might have observed various fishes. Their skin is covered with scales. These are cold-blooded. What does that mean, cold-blooded? Cold-blooded means they do not maintain an internal body temperature like we do. For example, if we talk about humans, we have a normal body temperature, that's internal body temperature. But when we talk about cold-blooded organisms do not have an internal body temperature. That means their body temperature depends on the temperature of environment. When we talk about humans, internal body temperature does not change with the environment, the temperature of our environment. For example, 37 degrees Celsius is our normal body temperature. This is 37 in summer and winter as well. It's not like when the temperature of environment is, for example, -1, our internal body temperature decreases. No, it's not like that. We maintain our internal body temperature, so we are warm-blooded organisms. When we talk about pisces or fishes, they are cold-blooded organisms. That means their temperature differs with the change in the temperature of their environment. And their heart is bilobed or two-chambered. That means their heart is divided into two chambers. When we talk about humans, we have four-chambered heart. That means our heart is divided into four chambers. But when we talk about the heart of pisces or fishes, it's divided into only two chambers. After that, as you know, these are aquatic organisms. So they have to use dissolved oxygen, which is present in the water. So they have some specialized organs for that, to use this dissolved oxygen. These structures are called as gills. So they use gills to obtain this dissolved oxygen. These are oviparous. That means they lay eggs. And they have fins and muscular tail, which they use for their locomotion. That means they move from one place to another with the help of fins and muscular tail. When we talk about their endoskeleton, some fishes have this endoskeleton made up of only cartilage. These fishes are called as cartilaginous fishes. While others, the endoskeleton of other fishes is made up of both bones as well as cartilage. These are commonly called as bony fishes. So this was all about this class Pisces. Now let's talk about another class, that's class Amphibia. This class Amphibia includes such organisms which live both on the land as well as inside the water. For example, we have frog. You might have observed it can live both inside the water as well as on the land. Their skin is smooth as compared to the scaly skin of Pisces. These amphibians do not have scales. Amphibians do not have scales on their body. Their skin is very smooth. As you might have observed a frog, the skin of the frog is very smooth and it's not covered by scales as compared to the fishes. These are also cold-blooded organisms. That means their internal body temperature depends on the external temperature of their environment. But their heart is three-chambered as compared to the two-chambered heart of Pisces or fishes. And their respiration is either through gills or lungs. And these are also oviparous organisms. So this was about class Amphibia. Now let's talk about class Reptilia. The class Reptilia includes organisms like snakes, lizards, turtles, crocodiles. These organisms come under this class, that's class Reptilia. And the characteristic features of this class Reptilia is their skin is dry and very rough. As you can imagine about these organisms which come under this group, that's turtles, crocodiles, lizards or snakes. Their skin is very dry and it's very tough and it's covered by scales, as that of the class Pisces. So their body is also covered by scales. Amphibians, when we talk about amphibians, their body is not covered by scales. These are also cold-blooded organisms. You already know what does that mean. And their heart is also three-chambered, as that of the heart of class amphibia. But except crocodiles. When we talk about crocodiles, they come under this class reptilia, but their heart is four-chambered as compared to the other organisms which come under this class. And they usually breathe through lungs. These are also oviparous organisms. That means they lay eggs. After that, another class is class aves, and it includes all the birds. This is the class which includes birds. Aves or birds. Huh? And their skin is covered by feathers, as you might have, you're well aware about this fact that body is covered by feathers. And when we talk about their forelimbs are modified into wings. And these wings help them to fly. After that, these are warm-blooded organisms as compared to the previous three classes, that's class Pisces, class Amphibia, and class Reptilia. These the organisms which come under these three classes. These are all cold-blooded organisms, but when we talk about class Aves or birds, these are warm-blooded organisms. That means they maintain their internal body temperature, and their internal body temperature does not depend on the body temperature of their environment. And their heart is four-chambered as compared to the other organisms, other classes, that's class Reptilia, Amphibia, or Pisces, where in class Pisces, they have two-chambered heart, while in case of Amphibia and Reptilia, the heart is three-chambered. But when we talk about class Aves, they have four-chambered heart, and they breathe through lungs. They have lungs for their respiration. And these are also oviparous, and that's a well-known fact. That means these aves are oviparous. After that, the final class is class Mammalia. These are the most advanced organisms of this kingdom Animalia. And when we talk about this class Mammalia, it includes diverse type of organisms. Some are aquatic, some are terrestrial. Some can fly while others can't. For example, bat also comes in this very particular group, in this class. Whale comes in this class, and also humans come in this class. So it's a very diverse class. It includes very diverse type of organisms. Now, what is the most important characteristic feature of this class Mammalia? That means they have mammary glands. And with the help of these mammary glands, they produce milk. That means they feed their young ones with milk. So this is the most important characteristic feature of this class Mammalia. When we talk about the different organisms which come under this class Mammalia, be it a bat or a whale or human beings, they all have mammary glands. And when we talk about these mammary glands, these are actually the milk producing glands which produce milk. And they feed their young ones with that very particular milk. Another feature is they have hair on their body, and sweat glands and oil glands on their skin as well. So these are the most important characteristic features of class Mammalia, which distinguish this class from all other classes of this phylum Chordata. That means they have mammary glands, they have hair on their body, they have sweat glands, oil glands. And like that of aves, these are also warm-blooded organisms, and their heart is four-chambered. And they breathe through lungs. And these organisms are mostly viviparous. That means they give birth to young ones. But the fact is, some of the organisms which come under this kingdom, this class, that's class Mammalia, some of them are oviparous as well. For example, we have platypus or echidna. Echidna is also called as anteater. So some organisms of this very particular class are oviparous as well. That means they lay eggs. While others like kangaroos, they give birth to a very poorly developed organism or young one. So there, such type of organisms are called as oviviparous. So it includes very diverse type of organisms. So this was all about class Mammalia. This was all about phylum Chordata, and this was all about kingdom Animalia. So we are done with this very particular unit. This very chapter, that is diversity in living organisms, actually comes in the U3 part of your syllabus. And in T1, we have to study natural resources. So inshallah, in the next lectures, in the coming lectures, we will try to learn about natural resources. We will learn about that very particular